Start recording. And good morning. It is our April 2nd monthly community call. We want to welcome you to Remote Pathways. I'm Jennifer Britton, one of the two podcasters, the voices behind Remote Pathways. So good morning, and I'm so pleased to be joined by my co-host, Michelle Mullins. How are you doing today, Michelle?
Grateful to be here, as always, Jen.
Yeah, as always, as we know, the world and our worlds continue to change. More than half the world right now is working remote. So we want to thank you for joining us. We hope that you'll tap into the varied resources that we have available and that it helps you thrive through these very moments in life. So Michelle and I have a quick activity. Michelle pulled those together. Michelle, do you want to lead us through this warm-up today?
Sure. So we're going to just play a little virtual morning game called What's on Your Remote Desk? So I would like you to just, because we're curious right now, right? Some of us are in the remote space for the first time, and we've just been caught up in the swirl of transition. So sometimes it's fun just to anchor ourselves and have a conversation around something simple on your desk. So we'd love to just hear what's on your desk today and share something. I love the little puppy. I have to sprinkle something in. One of our former guests, Jennifer Grody, she did a talk virtually and then later got a picture from someone that was watching, and the dog was so captured on the screen. It was like watching her. So it was just a great little fun thing. So that's why I sprinkled that dog in there. So maybe just take a few minutes. Which one of these pictures either represents your desk, or do you have something live that you want to bring into the camera shot and let us know? What's on your desk? What's on your remote desk?
Ooh, I like that question.
Yeah. Jen, what's on your desk?
Well, I have to admit right now it's Thursday, and as the week continues to roll out, like, my working pace has remained the same or volumized. So I think it looks like the upper left, right? I'm a very creative writer, so I always have files piling out. I'm very thankful that for Christmas, my family bought me one of those new EcoJet printers, so I can print to my heart's content and not be worried about running out of ink for 2 years. And I would love the creative yet very clean photo right below that on the middle left. I think that's what I'd love my desk to look like. And with that, I think our desks are a reflection, but we want to have the things that are important. So one thing that is important to me right now that I've been doing a lot of talking about is, of course, effective virtual conversations. And so I hadn't had this book, I wrote this and published it in 2017. I hadn't had it on my desk until a few months ago, but people are continuing to reach out, wanting tools and resources around having better conversations. And we're going to incorporate a couple of Zoom tips today, I think, if we have some time. So thanks for asking. And I'll put it back to you. And then maybe if Pat wants to bring her voice in as well, what do you have on your desk today, Michelle?
Well, I want to share, I have these little animal words of wisdom this year, and I'm just loving them. And I don't know if you can see this one, but it says, all you need is love. And it's for today. So I love it. It was a great way to start my day. So something that just brings a little cheer to my desk.
Nice. And Pat, we'll just invite you, if you'd like to bring your voice in. Which one are you choosing today?
Okay, so right now I'm just in my little corner that I have, a little corner desk, and that's all fine. And it's just my personal space most of the time. But I've found that lately I've been really working remotely. And so I have a couple of computers. And so I've been kind of working on a TV tray, which is to get away from my piles and just have that computer and just have that space and just be able just to focus on that and no other distraction. So that's what I kind of chose to do.
Love it. What I'm noticing, and I think the three of us are really representative of the very different types of working remote arrangements right now. Many of us have family members on the other side of the wall, whether they're sleeping or up and doing their own thing. And so In fact, some of our recent, our last episode, episode 9, was all about, are you working remote? Are you working virtual? Are you working mobile? Most of us are finding new work arrangements at home, and it may not be our standard, but notice what you like. I always think of being a little girl, and I used to have a little desk in our living room that I put my books on, and I guess that was the early seeds for me loving writing. But you know, what's going to bring you joy, to Michelle's question, what's going to bring you joy and what do you enjoy? So with that, Michelle, any final comments before we move on away from our desk?
Yeah, I would say we were having this conversation last night in our PDT call that it takes a little bit to get used to working in the remote space. So I love that Pat shared about the TV tray. Good for you finding that space in your house that was like, I'm getting away from the piles just so that I can focus. That is a great idea. and then also your kids or your husband or your dogs or your friends, somebody's going to walk through the background of your video at some point. So Being comfortable in the remote space is another thing that I just encourage people to do. It's okay.
All right. We're all human. At the end of the day, we're all human. And that's an interesting segue. I'm gonna move us into today's topic, because yesterday we just released episode 10, which was our special guest, Susan Combs. And Susan is one of my business partners. We launched a whole series of programming called the Mentor Roadmap about 4 years ago, 5 years ago now. And it supports formal mentoring programs in organizations. Those formal mentoring programs have taken place virtually and in person. And so today's topic is just a little bit on mentoring. And I think at all stages of our career, whether we're new to the workplace, new to remote work, seasoned, as I like to call myself, we can all benefit from a mentoring relationship, which is really a conversational connection with someone who helps us navigate the ins and outs of any industry. Our mentors help us see sort of the undercurrents that might exist. They may be the ones that can share their tips and tricks on how they did something. And they can also really help us avoid some of the pitfalls that we may not even see coming. So Michelle, mentoring, like, what's your connect to mentoring?
I love it. It's a huge piece of the relationships that I make sure that are in place for me in all areas of life, spiritual, personal, and professional. And then I've also liked to carry the question of like, wait, who can I, you know, kind of share some tips with too? So being on the lookout on ways to serve others. How about you, Jen?
And mentoring can be formal. It can be, you know, and when I say formal, it may be part of an organizational program. You may just reach out to someone and say, hey, I'd love to have a conversation. And would you be willing to mentor me as I move through this next phase of my business or as I take on this creative project? So just like a lot of the things we talk about here at Remote Pathways, it's grounded in great conversation. So listening skills are imperative, questioning skills, the ability to share our story in a way that is meaningful to someone else. What do you see as essential skills for mentoring? What do you see, Michelle, in your work?
I would agree with you that listening, right? Listening and then sharing wisdom, right? Back and forth. And then also calling out what's great in them, you know, who you're listening to, and helping them realize that they're further along than they think they are. It's just manifesting in their life. So it's new to them, but it's who they are naturally. So I like to call things out in people that they may not see.
Yeah, absolutely. And we can be so embedded in things, as many of us are in this moment in life, that having a conversation with someone else can really help us to frame things out, reframe things, you know, get that wise word of experience, which may be different than our pathway, but it can always create some new insights. So, you know, today's question is really like billions of people right now are working remote. Many of us have been in a stay in place, a quarantine, just remain at home for not just a few days, but a few weeks. And that creates a very interesting dynamic in our work. And I'm just curious, you know, think about what are your words of wisdom to others around remote work right now? What have you learned? And what is important to share? maybe we can do a bit of a round. And, you know, it's, even though remote work has been my world of work for 16 years, yesterday was year 16 anniversary of leaving my former world of service with the UN and returning back to Canada. And I think what I love, you know, like my word of wisdom is create what you love, because work is work, but hopefully we love what we do every day. And so create what you love. It may take longer. It always takes longer, I think, than we imagine. And having that clear vision in the big picture of what we want to create helps to also buffet us through moments of life like this, where, you know, things happen. And, you know, we may not have even perceived or seen it coming, but we do need to react. And I think that's where vision keeps us moving forward and moving at a pace. So what about you, Michelle? What's your word of wisdom? You've been doing this for a while as well. What do you suggest?
Yeah, investing in that, you know, I'm going to go back to that heart, right? So taking time to just connect with your heart and engage with your emotions and plan your day. Keep it simple. What are three things that you want to focus on? So yeah, just a gentle start into your day. That's one thing that you get to do in the remote space.
Yes. How do you want to start the day? Yeah. Pat, you've been working remotely as well. What if any tips do you have or words of wisdom you'd like to share?
Well, you know, I work remotely, but I also work remotely going into the office. So if I go into the office, when I go there, I'm working remotely to people. I'm in North Carolina. I'm working remotely with people all over the United States and Washington, D.C. A lot of conference calls. But now I'm home, working from home all the time and not going into the office. So it's a little bit different for me now than what it was. And so I'm finding that I have to be hyper-focused and take a time period of maybe 3 hours and really chunk my time. And so I'll take that period of time and really focus and then get up and leave it. And then just kind of do something else and come back and then chunk it again. And I'm finding that that's my best way to be more productive. Not to sit there the whole time and continue to work, because you just don't get productive doing that. So that's my suggestion.
Oh, that's such a great one. Yeah, I think across the board, so many of us do find that, you know, productivity looks a little different. And Michelle was mentioning last night, we had a plan, do, track call. There's a whole handful of facilitators now that are taking that workout into the world. And it's all about being a remote or virtual, like looking at the productivity lens of it. So how do we reduce distractions? How do we do our best work? How do we isolate what's important now versus later? What do you like? You do a lot of this in virtual retreats. So Michelle, what are some of the themes you hear from the clients you work with around PDT?
Yeah, I love what Pat just brought up, the focus burst, right? And I think you taught me that, sorry, still getting coffee this morning. and then Jennifer G, who is one of our former guests too, she reminds me of the being breaks that remind me that I'm a human being, because I'm so passionate about the work that I do. Sometimes I can sit here for hours. So yes, that chunking of time, but then using the in-between gaps to invest in social connection, the nutrition, am I moving my body? Am I taking a bathroom break? You know, just the simple things in life that you kind of do when you're in an in-office environment, because it kind of naturally happens. It doesn't, you have to do it intentionally in the remote space. So yeah, those little being breaks are good for productivity. We have a lot of conversations around that, just your lifestyle. And you have to go day by day right now. You know, you just figured out, what does today look like? You know, because there's so much uncertainty out there when things are going to shift again. So you just focus on the day. What can you do today?
Love that. Well, a couple of questions, other questions we put on the map here is like, are you a mentor or a mentee? And who do you look up to? Where do you find a mentor? You know, these are all great questions. And actually, Susan, I recall from our conversation, she was sharing a little bit about, you know, the roadmap she's taken groups and organizations through. Susan covers a lot of the US-based work. I cover a lot of the Canadian-based work. And you know, it's fascinating, I think, that one thing we're seeing across mentoring right now is something known as reverse mentoring. So reverse mentoring is where a more junior staff may mentor a more senior staff, often in the area of technology. And as we know, technology right now has been an enabler. I think for the last few weeks, depending on where you are in the world, many teams spent a week or so just struggling to get up and get online. And as that's happened, then a team can focus on what is the work we need to do now. And I think the conversation yet again this week has shifted to, okay, we know how to work remote, we're getting a handle on our tasks, but now how do we keep it moving strategically? So who do you look up to? I know for myself, even though I act as a mentor to so many people, it's always been important for me to have mentors, especially in those incremental moments of life. Like, I think many times as a business owner, as a leader, we have plateaus. And then in order to really move to the next level, it's so important that we do connect ourselves with people who have maybe done something a little different, maybe are a little bit further ahead than us, or bring skill sets that we just don't have. How about you, Michelle? Who do you look up to as mentors?
Well, you, of course. You have mentored me so much since 2013. So thank you for that, Jen, just teaching me how to be in this virtual space. And then a lot of people, you know, have a strong faith. So I have a lot of spiritual mentors as far as around discipleship. How do you share God's love right now? I have those questions and like to learn from them just to how to do that well. And then actually, my husband is a great mentor to me. He actually helped me with finding my rhythm in the remote space. He was my solution. I was looking online and he was right here with me. He comes from a military background, so he was great at helping me be efficient with my time and setting my office hours.
Nice.
Yeah. How about you, Pat?
Okay. Well, you know, you were talking about the reverse mentor, and I think that's really fascinating because I'm doing a Bible study, and I'm going to be doing Zoom for the first time remotely with a group of older ladies that they said, well, I'll try it. I'm not sure what I'm doing, but I'll give it a try. And so it'll be interesting. That's for tomorrow. And our series is Growing Older and Wiser. And one of our things, our next topic, is listening to the young and how important it is because they do have words of wisdom to share. And it's interesting that this is the topic because it was a challenge at work with one of our interns. And she might be losing her internship, and I'm trying to save it. And we have a conference call today to try to bring everything together. And one of my suggestions yesterday was that I was willing to mentor her and do whatever it took to try to guide her and get her where she needed to be. So this is like perfect timing. And I would say, I was kind of thrown into where I am in my workplace situation, where I really don't have a mentor. You just kind of figure it out for yourself, whatever needs to be done and how it needs to be done. So that's kind of interesting. And then you have other people under you that are, but they're not really under you. They're working with you and they're equals, but you know, you have a lot more knowledge than they do. But so you're mentoring them to bring them kind of up to speed as your partner. And that's kind of an interesting challenge. And I would say that my biggest mentor is Michelle. If I really need something, that's where I go because her words of wisdom are really very good for me, both spiritually and in the workplace and all the technology. So thank you, Michelle.
Oh, that makes my heart so warm. Like, thank you. Oh my goodness, what a gift. You are my mentor too.
It's a reciprocal arrangement. That's what we always say. The mentor learns as much as the mentee or the protege. And, you know, again, like different phases, different parts of our life, I think we have different mentors. So it's cute. I heard one of the dogs in the background also chiming in. So don't know if you heard.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, like we said, right? You just got to expect the unexpected in the remote thing.
Expect the unexpected, because you know what? Communication, it is what it is. Like, thank goodness for technology. We'll spend a couple of minutes. This is a Pat, I know you just mentioned, like, you know, working with others on Zoom. And I think, you know, technology has always been a great enabler. It's also been another a layer which creates or can create disconnect. So how do we help people learn to converse in this space? So maybe let's just do a little tidbit. We've got just a few minutes left in our call. Like, what's your favorite Zoom tip? Because a lot of people are using Zoom as well as the many other technologies that are happening. You know, Zoom, I've been using Zoom since probably one of its early days of infancy. I think one of my first calls was maybe back in 2014, if not earlier than that. It's been a while since I shifted all of my phone-based work and Skype-based work over to this platform. And I guess my favorite tip, one that I think is important as a host organizer, is my waiting room. And if you have a paid account, you can actually set up a waiting room, which means that you have a bit of a privacy barrier in terms of who's able to join you for calls and who's not. And as with any technology right now, we're seeing that trolls do take over certain rooms in Zoom. And so if you do have a paid account, and pricing, I think personally is quite reasonable compared to other providers, that you can set up a waiting room so that you can just, you know, ensure that you have control over who is with you in the room. Because if we're coaching, if we're mentoring, we're having a leadership conversation, a team conversation, we want to make sure that it's not only secure, but it's private as well. Mm-hmm. How about you, Michelle? What's a tip that you have for others? It might be very different than that very practical tip. What's your Zoom tip?
Well, actually, something I learned from you, the importance of the visual anchor, just like how we have it on the background right now. Even if it's just one slide or one picture, a visual anchor helps in the conversation in the virtual space.
And I want to thank Michelle for two things. First, she created this lovely new our new deck here at the community calls. And also, I love the photos that you picked out, Michelle. I don't think I told you that, but I love the photos that Michelle picked out for the desk. And just think of that variety. It just gives a whole, photos, imagery gives us a whole new energy. So think about one image, of course, respect intellectual property rights and laws. I always recommend go to places like Unsplash or purchase a commercial license. And I say that as a creative. Pat, how about you? Do you have a tip that you're gonna be sharing with your Zoom meeting folks later this week?
Well, I've been, you know, kind of investigating Zoom and kind of figuring out how to go about doing things. And as I was looking, I'm also helping my granddaughter who lives in Colorado with 11th grade math. And we were able to talk through it. And then when I really investigated Zoom, I found that there's a whiteboard. And I went, oh, that would be perfect. So the next time she needs help in math next week, I'm going to use the Zoom with her one-on-one and use the whiteboard.
Love it. And then you can work together. You can use annotation. You can mark on the screen. And these are really important things. You know, many of us are kinesthetic learners. We learn by doing. And I think on the surface level, we can think that just, you know, tech calls like this are really just passive, or we have to sit. While you don't want to be running around, you know, think about what movement you can incorporate safely, even if it's working on the screen together, co-creating, taking a screenshot of what you're doing as well. So there's lots of great Zoom tips. I've been sharing them a lot. Every Wednesday now, I'm running a one-day virtual facilitation training. It's called Virtual Facilitation Essentials. The last three Wednesdays, we've had a full house, people spending the day engaging in how do you use these tools? What's the best way to design slides? How do you really have a great conversation? And the final little piece I'll put out, because I just started it yesterday, I'm doing 90 days of readings, 5 to 6 minutes a day from Effective Virtual Conversations. I'm reading the book. So if you can't pick up a copy, because right now a lot of the printing presses are actually being redirected to other sources, which is a great thing, that I'll be doing a reading. And you can find those right now over at effectivevirtualconversations.com. And I'll probably link a few over to Remote Pathways as well, just to keep people in the loop. So that's my creative project for the month. How about you, Michelle? We stepped into a new quarter. I think it's important that we recognize that it's a new quarter as well in business. Is there a creative project you've got on the go that you want to share?
Yes, I'll say on the next call, yes, I will be more prepared to share. So right now I'm in the creativity waters with my business partner, putting together something around emotional intelligence, kind of a stress detox. That we're going to be opportunity that we're going to be able to share. So yeah, tune in to the next community call to find out the good stuff.
And with that, let's give you some more details because we're coming to the end of our call. So over at the Remote Pathways blog, just a reminder, every Monday there is a new weekly download. Recent downloads have covered communications. We're actually in week 13 now, but we wanted to reach back because part of making remote work successful is really thinking about how do you need to calibrate your communication. And when I said calibrate, I mean you might need to dial certain things up. You might need to dial certain things down. Just like these folks we have on the screen, we all communicate in different ways. So maybe that's also another area you want to explore, whether you use a strengths assessment. And of course, we had Jennifer Grody with us a few weeks ago at our strengths process. You may even use a DISC or other assessments to help think through how do you communicate, how do you like to be communicated with, and vice versa. Communication is about dialogue. Dialogue comes from the Greek word dialogus, which means two. We cannot communicate in isolation. So think about, and we won't have time, I think, today to talk about this in depth, but think about what you've been noticing about the working in a remote space and communication. This is one of the key remote enablers. We really want to make sure that we have great communication happening. As we mentioned at the top of the call, we had Susan join us, Susan Combs from Mentor Roadmap, and that was just released yesterday, our 10th episode, hard to believe, Yay. And it's called Mentoring in the Remote Space. And this is our episode download. So again, for anyone who is just joining us live for the first time on these calls at Remote Pathways, we really want to continue to act as a resource hub for all things remote work, whether you're a project manager, a sales professional, a remotepreneur, a leader, a coach. As we can see, 3 billion people are working remote right now very successfully. And so tap into the resource page that Michelle has set up over at remotepathways.com. Michelle, is there anything you want to say about our 10th episode and what you enjoyed as we recorded it with Susan?
It was fabulous. I could really see how mentoring could be a true gift in the world right now. So I encourage people to listen in and let it spark ideas for your team and reach out to both you and Susan because you have that wonderful structure that you can help any size of an organization just embed mentoring. And I really think it's going to be important in what's happening in the world today. And then another thing that I would just say kind of dropped in my heart in the middle of the night, if you're thinking of writing anything right now, write. Now is the time to write. When we're in these waters, we're connected with our emotions. If there's been something stirring in your heart, now is the time to write it. Use journaling prompts if you need to. So I meant to share that today. So I just wanted to put that out.
And I would just give a little shout out for a national nonprofit in the US called NaNoWriMo. In fact, it's April. And they always hold 30 days of focus on something they call Camp Nano, which is really an opportunity to either write or I'm using it to edit and do this creative work with the podcast, not the podcast, but with my audio readings. So with that, so much on the go, we hope that you have gotten a little bit more grounded in today's call. And our conversation sparker of the week is what communication skills need attention. So we are back together again every first Thursday of every month. We have added a second call in for this month in a couple of weeks just to keep the conversation going. And I think if memory serves me correct, we're going to be back here on Thursday, April 16th. Just after Easter at 7:30. We're going to make it a little later because, we do have people coming from all time zones. So with that, always a pleasure, Michelle. Join us in the coming weeks. Michelle's going to talk about emotional intelligence. I've shared a little bit about virtual facilitation essentials. And be sure to check out remotepathways.com. Always a pleasure to be with you, Michelle, at the start of a Thursday. Thanks for all that you bring to our relationship. And Pat, I'm so glad that you could join us for yet another community call.
Thank you, both Jennifer and Michelle. It's always a pleasure, and I'm always learning something.
Love it. Final words from you, Michelle, before we wrap up.
Just a heart. All you need is love.
I'll end with what we started with. All you need is love.
Circle, close the circle. And with that, everyone, have a great week. We'll see you in a couple weeks for our next call. Take care.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.